Kelly, after all of that holiday spending, let's talk about saving money. Where do you start?
Yes, Larissa. Now, I actually wish it were kind of the olden days where we would get the credit card statements in the mail. I know a lot of people don't miss those days, but the problem is because so many of us bank electronically, we don't even see our statements. We don't comb through them anymore. We don't look at our interest rates. So where do we start? Just like you would on January 2nd or 3rd, you want to first weigh in financially. Now, I know that's really hard to do for a lot of Canadians, but what that means is really digging into your financial situation. What interest rates are you paying? What is your debt? And then also maybe on the flip side, if you've done a great job with savings and you've had that opportunity, revisiting that as well. Because Larissa, I'm hearing from so many people, either themselves or maybe adult children who are helping their parents out, that because we're still in a high inflation inflationary environment, maybe, moving to a GIC or something of that sort really makes sense. So first, you want to weigh in financially. Second, you really want to count those financial calories because no matter how much you go to the gym, it matters what you eat. The same with your finances. And then very lastly, if all of that is just too overwhelming, know when you really need to bring in that professional, if it's a financial planner or a nonprofit credit counselor, to help you, navigate and strike a game plan.
I know you started off talking about the good old days, but let's maybe take that conversation forward. And have you seen conversations around money change? Do you find people are becoming more vocal about conversations around money?
Yes, yes and no. It kind of depends. It depends if it's, within families, if it's with your friends, and maybe even in the workplace. And Larissa, it tends to be generational. Like the younger generations are talking a lot more as well. There's this new trend that I really love called loud budgeting. It's a TikTok. Talker. I'm not even on TikTok, but I've been watching the trend. His name is Lucas Battle. And basically, being vocal about, again, back in the old days, Larissa, I don't know about you, but my parents would say things like, "We can't afford it." Now, maybe they really couldn't afford it, or maybe they could, but we used to use those terms. Now, in our fast-paced society of tap and go and easy credit, we don't say that anymore. And I think this loud budgeting trend is very exciting because basically what it's all about is saying no to stuff that you don't want to be influenced in buying. And I think that's amazing. And especially for a lot of your viewers, it may apply to their adult children and maybe to them as well, because we definitely are lured by that. Maybe you can afford it, but it means you foregoing your RSP contribution, not leaning into your employer matching programs. So bringing this term to light, having these conversations, it makes me think of a Friends episode where the poor friends were out for dinner with the rich friends, and at the end of the dinner, it was like, "Hey, let's split the bill." And the poor friends were like, "Look, we just had water and some free bread. Why do we have to split the bill with you?" So I know money conversations can be very sensitive and hard to bring up, but having, it's a new year, it's a new time, people are facing a lot of financial pressures. I think letting people know that you're on a budget, letting people know you're maybe saving for a home, you're trying to lean into your retirement, it helps everyone be more respectful of maybe some of the invites that they're bringing your way and opting for maybe a coffee date versus a cocktail date.
Let's talk about that budget reboot. And what is the 30-day anti-budget?
Well, I don't like budgets because I think they're like diets. I think for a lot of people, they don't stick. Now, if you're a great budgeter, by all means, just tune out the next couple of seconds. But Larissa, what happens is when we constrict our behavior and we don't want to do it, we bounce back from that scarcity mode, and often we bounce back so much worse. So, for those of your viewers that don't like budgeting or helping out their adult kids, for me, it's something I've been asking my readers to do for over 10 years. It's an exercise in choice and awareness, not in sacrifice. So my husband and I are doing another one right now. We do it at least once or twice a year. Actually, we started in November and we're keeping going. So we've just got a big poster in the kitchen wall from the dollar store. Yes, you can take it down when people come over if you don't want them to see what you're doing. And we just write all the money coming in, all the money going out. And it really, you know, I don't think we have the studies when it comes to finance, but certainly in health, if you want to lose weight, just tracking your calories is enough to help you be more mindful and see where your calories are going. I think the same exercise works very well for people, tracking your financial calories. And then it helps you see, look, at the end of 30 days, Larysa, you're going to see the spending trending for your family, not what some expert says you should spend. And then you multiply it by 12. So you see what that annual number is. And a lot of times people are blown away. I mean, subscriptions, people are spending over $3,600 a year. If you're using them, great. But if you're not, huge waste of money. How about food waste? Speaking about waste, that's something we struggle with in our household. Canadians are wasting over $1,300 a year on average in food waste. So by tracking, by adding it up, you really see where your money's going, where you can trim the fat without sacrifice. And then that can go either towards savings or debt repayment. And Larysa, one multimillionaire who did my 30-day anti-budget challenge, he didn't need to, but he realized he was spending $3,600 a year on Diet Coke and opted for a $200 soda stream. Better for his health and better for his pocketbook for sure.
I love Diet Coke, Kelley.
I do too. Just maybe not $3,600 worth the year.
you've mentioned cutting debt, and at the start of the conversation, you had talked about those credit card statements. Yeah. Another aspect are, I guess, taking a look at your credit cards, taking a look at those costs, at bank account fees.
Yes. I mean, that adds up so much, and it's not something that we think about. And Larysa, I'm talking to a lot of Canadians that are pretty stretched, especially small business owners. Maybe their credit cards are maxed out and, you know, they literally don't have a dollar more a day or $5 more a day to slash that credit card debt. Let's say you had a $10,000 balance. You have a 24.99% interest rate on your credit card. You did one thing only, you're making the minimum payment and you called up your bank and got into a lower interest rate card. Yes, all banks have a lower interest rate credit card. Now, they're not going to call you to tell you that this option exists, but let's say you were able to get in one at around 12.99%. That one move by having your, you know, slashing your credit card interest rate in half on that example of a $10,000 balance, paying no more, saves you over $5,000 during the life of that credit card repayment. So, you know, I get that people feel really apathetic when there isn't enough money at the end of the day. Again, a lot of your viewers might be helping out their adult children or teens, you know, showing them that there's always something that you can do, even when you think that it's fixed, makes a huge difference. And yes, if you switch into that lower interest rate credit card, there's no bells and whistles, there's no rewards points, but you don't need them. Once you get back up on your feet, of course, you can go back into those types of cards. So great time to look at, you know, a lot of people have multiple bank accounts and they're paying $5, $15, $12 a month on all of those. Again, in my 30-day anti-budget, you're going to see that adds up to hundreds of dollars that wasn't in your pocket. Those credit card annual fees can add up as well. So, you know, get on the phone with your banker, get online, look at all the different credit card options that are out there. This is a great time of year. If you don't have time to do it right now, put it in your digital calendar, put a little reminder to comb through these expenses in the future.
What are your thoughts on cashback cards or cashback apps?
I love cashback. I love rewards. I'm very loyal with my credit cards. I'm very loyal with my airlines and hotels, and they have paid in spades for me as a business owner, as an entrepreneur that travels a lot. The caveat is paying that credit card off in full every single month. And also, Larysa, really digging into, you know, there's some great cards out there with some really amazing rewards and exclusive offers, but you're paying for that. So it's a really good opportunity, like I said, to look at What is that annual fee? I mean, there's no fee cards. You're not getting any perks with those. There's cards I've seen up at $600-$800 a year for an annual fee and everything in between. So you really want to make sure you're getting bang for the buck, and that, you know, whatever those rewards or cash back or you've chosen, that it actually fits your needs. If you're traveling a lot, you use rental cars, make sure you're getting the coverage that you expect that you're getting, because just because you're with one bank and they have multiple cards, they also have multiple features. So really understanding what those benefits are and making sure that it was worth paying that annual fee at the end of the day.
And just lastly, I know you had mentioned the employer matching program. Just taking a look at other options that are available, maybe additional income that's being left on the table.
Yeah. You know, I find it shocking. Sun Life comes out with this stat every year that $3 to $4 billion is being left on the table by Canadians every year in not leaning into their employer matching programs. And that's not even your wellness account. So if you're traditionally employed, please reach out to your HR department. You may have a plan where your employer matches your RSP contributions or your TFSA, or things you're going out of pocket for, like a yoga mat or new gym equipment or what have you. Your wellness account might be covering you for that. I mean, people are burnt out and exhausted. If you're leaving a free massage or acupuncture appointment on the table, please definitely call up your HR department or really look at those benefits. And I know, again, people are stretched, but if you do the anti-budget, if you comb through your benefits and you see, wow, not only are you saving for yourself with your employer, but there may be matching another $1,000 or $5,000 or whatever it is, do everything you can to take advantage of that, because that is a lot of money every single year being left on the table.